coming in at number 88, we have Philadelphia Eagles tight end Zach Ertz. And, you know, I apologize to Eagles fans because I just realized how confusing this whole ordeal might be. For those who don't know, the Eagles run two tight ends on a large majority of their snaps. They're on Zach Ertz, number 86, and Dallas Goedert, number 88. So before you type that comment, no, Dallas Goedert's number 88. No. Number 86, Zach Ertz, is number 88 on my top 100 list. Don't get it twisted here because, you know, it's already tough to figure out who is who on film, but Zach Ertz is the one that's on the list. So in all seriousness, though, you know, Ertz has really just been the model of consistency at that tight end spot over these past couple years. You know, in the last five, actually, he's had over 70 receptions and over 800 yards each season, which has been, it's been really invaluable to Carson Wentz's development in really just becoming one of the league's top quarterbacks. And, you know, even just these last three seasons, he's had years of eight and six touchdowns. Like, that's so impressive when you consider he's not as maybe athletically gifted as the George Kittles or Travis Kelce's, but yet his production is kind of right there with him. And, you know, he might not be in their tier, but he's kind of in a tier of his own as really that third best tight end in the league. And that's why he's number 88 on my list. And first things first, in terms of what makes Ertz so special, to me, really just his size and his frame jumps off the tape. Because when you consider the Eagles are lining him up out wide, like he's a wide receiver on a lot of plays, just the fact that he's 6'5" and 250 pounds makes him an absolute matchup nightmare for really any defensive back in the NFL. You know, so I just love this play because it's a little curl route where he's able to, once he flips those hips, just use that big old body of his to almost like a power forward or center on the low block, boxing out for a rebound, has able to just ignore all that noise behind him and, you know, kind of fight through that contact to just secure that ball and get an easy first down. In line with his frame, though, is Ertz's body control. And, you know, for a big guy like that, you often don't see somebody who's able to manipulate their body in the ways that Ertz is. So look at him here on this play that kind of breaks down. In case you lose track, he is over here on the sidelines. And just look at him come back to this ball and, again, just fight through that contact by this time all-pro safety Harrison Smith and just secure the catch. It's so impressive because, you know, I talked about it a couple of videos ago with Kenny Galladay where it's like he's almost like a puppet where you're controlling his upper body with one string and his lower body with another. Well, Ertz is kind of built in that same vein where, again, he's able to get those feet secure on the ground in the field of play, but at the same time extend that upper body and really utilize that 6'5" frame to grab a catch that he really didn't have any business of grabbing. And you often hear that a good tight end is a young quarterback's best friend, and that's really what we've seen here in Philadelphia between Ertz and Wentz. And a primary reason behind that is just Ertz's massive catch radius and his ability to go up and grab balls in any direction that a lot of guys wouldn't be able to grab. And again, it's just because of that massive frame, and, you know, he has a 30-inch vertical, so he's already 6'5", going up 30 inches. It's just really special how he's able to utilize those long limbs, utilize that big body, and pull down balls that might not be the most accurately thrown. Whereas, you know, with a guy like DeSean Jackson, you might have to put it in a specific area. With Ertz, you kind of just put it generally anywhere around here, and he's money. And kind of right there with his body is just Ertz's physicality. And I don't know where the stigma came that Ertz, you know, he can't run block. Oh, he's not physical. He's soft as a pillow. Because that's not exactly accurate to what we see on the field. You know, here he is going up against New England, and you're going to see him do a nice job fending off Eric Rowe. But then just as the play breaks down, he's able to grab the ball, stiff arm Danny Shelton, stiff arm Jamie Collins, and turn what would have been a 3rd-and-15 into a 3rd-and-1. It's just plays like these that, you know, a lot of guys aren't necessarily making, especially guys who have that reputation that, oh, they're diva receivers. Well, Ertz kind of has that for some reason when it's not reality. And here's a play where Ertz uses that physicality to really create some separation and get himself open downfield on a post route against Kyle Fuller. Obviously, I know a lot of people will debate if this should have been called for offensive pass interference. It wasn't on the field, and personally, I don't really think it should have been either because Fuller flops quite a bit. But it's just a good example of where Ertz lacks in terms of just straight line speed and, you know, maybe acceleration, how he's able to make that up in terms of just his strength and physicality to really get himself just open enough to secure the ball at the catch point and, you know, on this play, get a pretty easy touchdown. And just in case you guys thought that last one was OPI, I made sure to grab another one that is definitely clean and, in my eyes, way more impressive as well when you kind of strip away the layers and really consider and get keyed into what's going on. So here we have Eagles Seahawks. Eagles need 10 yards for a first down, and the Seahawks, to kind of counter that, it appears that they're running their bread and butter. They're a zone coverage heavy team, and what this looks like to really the naked eye, is a cover three zone shell because they have that single high safety. And essentially, this is what you think is going to happen on the snap of the ball. You have Shaq Griffin and Trey Flowers covering deep as well with Quandre Diggs. You're going to have Bradley McDougald in the flat. These two linebackers, KJ Wright and Bobby Wagner, guarding the middle of the field in that kind of hook to curl range. And then the other flat defender on the opposite side, right? So the Eagles, they know this, right? They're going to try and counter that. So what are they going to dial up? They're going to dial up what's called a flood route concept, right? So essentially they're going to try and really overload this side of the field and isolate this flat defender in Bradley McDougald. So what's that going to look like? Boom. So what you're going to have is that outside defender, he's going to run a streak to kind of clear out this cornerback, and then you're going to send the running back on a flare out of the backfield, and then you're going to have Ertz run an out route. And as I said, what's that going to do? It's going to isolate Bradley McDougald, and essentially, if he comes up, you bang it in behind him, and if he stays back on Ertz, you toss it to the running back. It's really a perfect play for cover three, right? So that's what Doug Peterson and company dialed up. Well, what actually happens, though? That's the question. So let's get rid of those, and what you're going to see on the snap of the play is that the Seahawks are actually in cover one, which means they're running man coverage. So it's almost the perfect counter now to a flood concept play, because everybody's manned up. So instead of isolating anybody, you're going to have Shaq Griffin for that wide receiver. You're going to have Bobby Wagner for the running back, and you're going to have Bradley McDougald on Ertz for that out route. But what actually happens on the play is that Ertz, despite being manned up, despite anticipating zone coverage as a result of the play call, he's still going to use his physicality to force his way open. That's what you're going to see. He's going to take this route stem right into Bradley McDougal, run right through his chest, and then get open on the out route. Let's see if you guys can see what I'm talking about. There's the contact, there's the physicality, and there's the out route to get open. So hopefully you guys kind of understood what I was saying there. But the Seahawks had a perfect play call to counter this flood concept. It was just Zach Ertz's physicality that gets him open and gets him enough separation to give Josh McCown an easy pitch and catch for the Eagles' first down conversion. And it's plays like these that the defense was ready for perfectly and had dialed up perfectly, but Zach Ertz's physicality puts it over the top in terms of him just creating that separation when it shouldn't be there and making a play on a ball that they didn't really deserve to have caught. And I also wanted to shed light a couple really nice blocks I saw Zach Ertz make, because I don't think that he's nearly as bad as everybody just seems to think in the top of their head. So here we're going to have his Ertz and Goddard combo blocking Kyler Fackrell down, and then Ertz kind of instinctively breaks off and is going to end up blocking Adrian Amos here and creating a huge lane for Jordan Howard to run through. Is it the prettiest block in the world? No, but look at how he sees Kyler Fackrell is still hanging on Goddard's outside. Well, Ertz gets a really nice hit on him. He displaces Fackrell out of his gap, and then he realizes, oh, hey, there's Adrian Amos as well. What am I going to do? I'm going to wheel back around on him, just wall him off just enough. And as a result, Jordan Howard is able to turn something on nothing and put the Eagles right on the Packers' doorstep. And here's another example where he's not making as important of a block, but still look at how he just gets into Jordan Poyer and drives him 5 yards deep into the end zone. You know, at the very least, you can talk about the strength and the effort on this play. And, you know, for a guy who is supposedly like Charmin soft as a run blocker, I don't hate it. What I actually love, though, is Ertz's ability to run some really nice routes and manipulate his defenders as a result, right? So you're not going to be able to see it as much from this broadcast view. From this view, it just looks like a nice little out route. But from the more tight view, what you can see is how Ertz creates that separation and is able to get just a half yard on Terrence Brooks that really gets him open enough to where Wentz can fit it in there. So what you're going to see is off the snap, I apologize for that, I didn't get a pause in there at all, but what you're going to see is right here, I want you to look at his right leg. So see how that right leg is crossing over top his left? So what that kind of suggests to Terrence Brooks as he's trying to figure out and mentally process what route is this, Terrence Brooks thinks that this is an inward breaking route, because typically the direction that your feet are going, that's the way your body's going to be going, right? Well, not quite with Ertz. So what you're going to see here then is he's able to plant that right foot in the ground and actually turn his body to the outside, even though, you know, where his legs are, it would appear he's about to break inside. So what happens with Brooks? Well, as a result, Brooks starts to sink inward because he's worried and he's thinking that he's going to be cutting inside. Well, Ertz as you see, he already points that left foot on the outside now, and then he's able to push off that and generate just enough space as a result of him basically making Brooks think that he had an inward breaking route. I'll show it for you guys one more time. What you're going to see is really Brooks off the snap. You can tell he's initially thinking in breaking route because just look at his shade compared to Ertz. Obviously, he's, what, half a step inside, nothing crazy. But then again, once that right foot gets planted, watch how Brooks kind of takes two steps to the right, puts himself out of position, and Ertz is able to get that outside leverage and eventually get just enough separation to reel in the ball and get an easy first down for the Eagles. And here's another really, really good example. What you're going to have here is essentially a tight end angle route. I know some people might call it a post, but it's underneath enough to where I'd still call it an angle. So what you're going to have is Ertz running straight at Campbell to where Campbell, in his mind, he realizes he thinks that, oh, this might be a corner route. This might be something outward breaking because he's coming at me hard. You know, that route stem is pointing towards the sideline. So what does Campbell do? He goes with Ertz, and just when Campbell flips those hips and points those feet towards the sideline, Ertz is able to hit a nice little swim move, looking like he's a defensive end, back inside, gain inside leverage on Campbell, and there's Carson Wentz waiting with the nice pitch and catch. It's just his ability to get clean releases off the line of scrimmage and run some really crisp routes and make defenders think he's doing something that he's not. Because, again, he just has that size advantage. So a defender, they know that they have to be in the right position every play if they want to defend a ball. Well, as a result, you have Devondre Campbell. He's trying to read his keys, and, you know, he reads them correctly, but Ertz gives him the incorrect keys. And then once he hits that swim move, comes back inside, he has plenty of separation to make the catch and get the first down for Philadelphia. You know, I didn't talk about his release as much on that last play, but I do like his release here because what you're going to see is him basically being kind of bracketed a little bit by Ziggy Ansah and Trey Flowers. Well, Zach Ertz, he doesn't really care. He's going to eat this press by Ziggy Ansah, and then again, he's going to run just a nice crisp in route and make the catch even though Trey Flowers is right there. So again, he gets off that press. He's able to somehow create just enough space back on the inside and make a really nice play. It's routes like these where even though he's being pressed and being covered by somebody else, they're still able to get open and as a result be Carson Wentz's kind of go-to target underneath on a lot of plays. But even when Zach Ertz isn't really open, he's pretty open actually, just because of, again, all those physical intangibles, but more importantly, his hands and his ability to concentrate and reel these balls in. So what you're going to see here is him running an in route against Shaquille Griffin with Bradley McDougald right underneath and Quandre Diggs breaking down on it. But again, look at how he's just able to grab this ball, pick it out of the sky, and make a really nice catch coming across the middle of the field despite having three Seahawks defenders all converging on him. It's plays like these that, you know, not a lot of tight ends are making in space, and not even a lot of receivers are making that in space going across the middle of the field because you know you're about to get hit. You know you have a guy draped all over you already. Again, with Ertz's size, with Ertz's strength, with his hands, he's able to turn what really should be a nicely covered play by Shaq Griffin into a first down for Philadelphia. And these last two, you know, just because he's not the best athlete in the world doesn't mean that he can't make plays after the catch. So that's all I wanted to highlight here, just his ability to, really, once he does bring the ball in, transition from receiver to runner and make plays. Because, no, he's not the most athletic guy, but he is a pretty tough-to-tackle guy when you consider that size and that strength that he possesses. So, you know, here's just a nice play with him going over one defender and taking another one to bring him down, 10 yards downfield, just a really solid play. And that takes us into the last one. This time it's Zach Ertz going to be on the sideline and then outrunning another two guys. This is really him putting everything together. You're going to see a nice crisp out route. You're going to see him go up, high point that ball along the sidelines, show some nice body control, you know, put the hands to work, and then just put on the jets and outrun another two defenders and narrowly miss a touchdown for the Eagles. It just plays at these where he is putting everything together that has made him Carson Wentz's really number one target since he's entered the league, and it made him number 88 on my mic'd up top 100. As always, if you guys enjoyed the video, make sure to leave a like, make sure to leave a comment. You know, tell me what you think of Zach Ertz. Is he getting a little up there in age for you and you wouldn't have put him this high? Or do you think after that really 5-year consistent sample that I talked about earlier, after that, would you think he should be higher? So it's an interesting discussion to be had. But ultimately, unless you continue to tune in to really the remaining 87 videos in the series, you won't know where he should have fell. So as always, be sure you subscribe, get these videos in your sub boxes. I'm as I always say, I'm really enjoying making these. I hope you guys are enjoying them just as much. So with that being said, I'm mic'd up. Now I'm micing out. Peace, guys.